thank you very much for the introduction. So it's my real pleasure to be here today and to talk to you about biologically inspired flying robots, or UAVs. And although this is my title, what I really want the title to be is Drones for Humanity. Now, drones have a somewhat negative connotation, but they can be used for many humanitarian and beneficial applications that can enhance smart cities in our society to help us all. Now, to start with, let me start with a small movie clip. Just a few seconds. Now, have a look at that. So it's a sunrise, right? It's a nice city. There are birds in swarms flying freely. And now if you see that, and you have an engineering soul, let's say, right? If you want to build things, then you naturally want to copy that. You want to build robots. You want to build artificial machines that can fly freely as well. So this is often the start for robotics. It was the start for the wish or the dream of flying. And this is how robotics started in the early days. Now, the first robots, although they were not robotics, there was pigeon delivery, right? So they were delivering posts between cities, so very successfully. Other applications include pigeon photography, although before this, so it's big, heavy cameras with pigeons. It worked somewhat well, right? But so today we have the, I call this the drone revolution, where the, our pigeons are a bit more sophisticated and they can be carried. So these are off-the-shelf solutions that can be carried like that in a suitcase and launched off and take pictures of the environment, map the environment and create maps like that. So they can autonomously fly typically along GPS coordinates and be used for agriculture, inspection, different applications and create a 3D map. So the market is there now already. Now, what is the next step? What are the major challenges? Where do we want to go? Where is the field going? And so there are some movements. So for, on one side, we have the consumer type robots for a few hundred pounds. You can get one of those, you can fly with your iPad. So that's already on the market as well, very successfully. But there are big companies that invest now into developing solutions for delivery, such as Amazon, DHL, or also providing internet coverage in inaccessible areas such as Facebook that have drone networks flying in the skies. So these are the next steps of the next few years, I would say, roughly. Overall, the market of flying robots or unmanned aerial vehicles is about $90 billion. So it's one of the most growing markets. It's a very dynamic space where many new companies start and get developed. Now just one word about drone delivery, because many people are talking about that. So there is a huge potential for that to deliver goods between cities, let's say, especially in areas that have no strongly developed infrastructures, such as the developing world, like Africa, for example, where the infrastructure is not developed. So then you can, instead of developing the infrastructure, there's a big push in developing drone networks right away. So the same happened with mobile phones. So they went very quickly into wireless technology instead of going into more technology, like more wire-based system. So, but there are still big challenges, which is how to interact with the cities, how to take off, how to avoid obstacles, and how to land here. So this is somewhat solved along GPS coordinates, but there are a lot of other challenges when you want to move in cities. Now one example is this, just to show you some challenges. It's, this is Thomas Creedy, it's one of our PhD students in the lab. And he's a biologist and he's testing these flying robots in the rainforest for ecological monitoring. And so taking one of those off-the-shelf drones, you see it's really difficult to fly them in the forest. There's wind, everything around the robot moves, right? So if it touches a tree, it just crashes very quickly. So the technology is not yet there to move in complex, cluttered environments. So this is a real challenge, so the field is not there yet. Besides forests, other challenges are cities. So how do you fly safely close to humans? How do you interact with buildings? How do you take off, land in locations where GPS is not precise enough? Or how do you move close to water, close to cliffs, or in between different media? Or if you want to inspect some structure, let's say here an oil platform, you want to inspect here the pillars or some pipe work or leaks, for example, how do you do that without crashing into the pipe? So there's real challenges that are now being solved. Now, talking about smart cities and how they can be enhanced with flying robots, our lab is working on drones that can live inside of those cities and provide us with information and help us to improve our quality of life. Now, besides the drone delivery, we are working in particular on drones for environmental monitoring or to monitor the ecological parameters in the environment. We work on drones for water health, so drones that can dive into water, take water samples, look at underwater facilities in rivers, for example, or lakes in urban ecosystems. And also we look at drones for inspection and repair, so to actually repair buildings together with smart buildings. So the next few minutes I will talk you through some of those prototypes to show you how some of those robots can be used in future cities. So starting off the drones for environment, so what's a big challenge in agriculture is how to successfully manage those environments. So how much fertilizer do you have to put on it, how much water, how much pesticides. And in cities that's very important, there is ecosystems in cities, and also there you want to manage those very successfully and precisely. So for that we look at robots that can land here and detect the parameters, and like this tailor, we can tailor the applications of the pesticides and chemicals we want to put into the soil there. Now just to show you how we do that, as an inspiration for the builders among you who want to actually develop robots, is that you take the biologically inspired approach and you look at the animals, for example here a grasshopper, and you try to extract the design principles, so what makes these animals very successful jumpers, and how can we use the same principles and information in our robot, and then take off like this, transition to the air. It can jump about 1.4 meters, which is really high for its size. And this is because we're actually able to extract those principles from the animal kingdom to build better robots. Now, as an application, you can imagine this robot that we built that can actually recover and jump again. So just showing that the jumping locomotion can really increase locomotion capabilities. And so for mobility, for example, if you want to move in a smart city, a small robot with wheels or legs would not be able to overcome stairs or move over complex terrains. So jumping actually can help in that. So you can imagine a swarm of jumping robots being in cities to detect pollution, environmental pollution thresholds and so on and so forth. Okay, so the way how we do that, we look at the animal, we extract the principle, which is having a four-bar leg mechanism, energy storage principles and so on, and then we implement that in the design, which you then fabricate on the robot. So this I call the bio-inspired robot design principles, which go through the abstracted principles and not by copying the animals. So all that's biologically inspired doesn't have to look the same like the animals, because then maybe the animal is optimized to look like that to attract a lot of female animals. So there might be other constraints for the animals. So we are really interested in some of the key components that makes it very successful in what we want the robots to do. Okay, so next step is animals that actually don't just jump, but they jump and glide. And so like the flying squirrels or flying fish, and also there we looked then into this jump gliding of how we can use that those robots would be living on roofs of buildings and then use the height that they have to transition, glide down, perch to objects, observe the environment, and really move intelligently in the smart city. Okay, so the next is the drones for water health. So this is very important actually because let's say you have a river and you have some kind of pollution in the river, or you have a flooding situation. And in floods, what often happens is that there is a bacterial contamination of the floods. Then you want to really know where this happens so you can save the people more quickly in these areas, because they really, that's one of the big hazards in flooding situations. So there you can imagine that these smart robots would live in the city, fly around, detect the pollution levels in the flooding situation, and then communicate this back to a helicopter to go there. So currently all that is done manually, which is much more expensive, much more costly, much more risky for humans, and takes much more time as well. Okay, so there, we look also at animals that do transitioning between air and water that can actually fly and dive. And so these are gannets, actually you might know them. There are many animals that do that, different birds, and what they do in particular is that they fold the wings, they crash into the water for catching fish, obviously they're interested in fish. But the question is, can we use similar principles as they do for diving into the water, taking pictures underwater, detecting facilities, any leakage, for example, and taking a water sample to then fly back. So we analyzed that, but also flying squid and flying fish and other animals. And we built this into these aquatic micro aerial vehicles, or aquamap, as we call them. And they can be applied for applications such as you have an oil spill, for example, or any kind of chemical accident. And you cannot go there manually to sample it, so you would have these swarms of robots that would fly there and sample those, do the water sampling. So they would be then able to follow the wings, dive into the water, take a water sample, and then have a high power propulsion system to transition back to flight and come back to the base station where the data can be analyzed. That's basically distributed data gathering in an intelligent, very quick way. So this is one of the projects that we work on. So the current prototype looks like that. And just to show you, give you a glimpse of the capabilities of it, we positioned here, so it's a small scale system, and using a water jet propulsion mechanism similar to flying squid, how they jump off the water, actually we are able to show they can jump a distance of around 100 times its size. So if you see it here, it takes off, right? It's a really very high power density propulsion system that can be used on flying robots to then transition from water to air back to the air to fly there. Okay, so as a last area that I would just like to show you some prototype for inspiration is drones for inspection and repair. Now, this is important for, let's say you have a roof of a building, you have solar panels, and so it's very difficult to go there physically and be human, so to actually repair something. So instead of that, you could have flying robots that would go there, repair it without any human intervention. Or other applications is like a wind turbine, where there is a crack, for example, so instead of shutting it down, going there manually, you can have robots that lift together with the wind turbine to repair it very quickly. So and there also we look at animals, and some of those are really amazing of how they actually build those structures, how they can actually repair and adapt to different environments to create structures. So an example is spiders. The spider webs, and they do these spider webs between different, like between trees where you don't know the geometry. Now in a search and rescue situation, you also don't know the geometry of collapsed buildings, so how can you build structures in between those areas? So this is something we look at and try to extract different principles how to do that successfully. Another example is the editable nest swifts. You might be familiar with that, so they are the bird's nest soups. If you try that, yeah, it's a delicacy apparently. I've never tried it, it's made of the saliva of these birds. And so what they do is they use the saliva to build their nests repetitively. So they put a lot of the saliva, they wait until it hardens, and then this they can build up the structures. So they basically 3D print their nest with their saliva. Now, learning from that, we built a 3D printing drone. So a flying robot that can 3D print using the expanding foam, like this, if there is any damage, it would be able to go there and 3D print structures to repair or also to build up material to create some desired structure. So to give you a quick video of a demo, how the system works at the moment. So that's a drone, it hovers, there's this expanding foam. So we use expanding foam because it expands by a factor of 25, so it's very, you can build very large structures for very little material on the drone. And you see it's fairly precise actually, and if you do this repetitively, you can build material up or seal gaps or fractures repetitively, like termites do to build up structures. So something like this similar could be used also for thermal management of buildings, which is something that I guess Matthew from Cubot later might be talking about as well. Okay, so besides these applications, it can also just be used to print the lab logo all over the place. So it's just a cool application. Okay, so if you want to see it, at the moment it's exhibited in the Science Museum, so the antenna gallery in the back of the ground floor, so you can look at the system, but we also have a stand in the back where you can talk and look at some of our robots. Now, other robots, other projects also we look at is 3D scanning with drones. So we can have stereo vision cameras or different depth sensors to fly, detect any damage with a 3D scanner, and then a 3D, use a 3D printer to repair and build up materials. Okay, so just a few words to finish last 2 minutes or so. I'm on the Imperial College. Now, Imperial College is located here, so it's Hyde Park, right? This is the Royal Albert Hall of Science Museum is here. It's South Kensington in London. It's a rather nice area to be in, so you're all welcome to visit if I can host you if you want. But to mention, so at Imperial they have 18 groups that work in robotics. So our group is the only one doing flying robots, but we have 18, so we have about, so I don't know how many researchers, about 200-300 researchers working in robotics, so it makes us one of the biggest centers in Europe doing different applications of robotics. The common areas are biorobotics, so biology robotics, and combinations between living cybernetics, like living systems, and robotics. So our lab is located here in this building. We have a rapid prototyping center. We just spent about $5 million last year on buying new 3D printers and different facilities, so we can fabricate whatever we want, basically. So it's very well equipped. We're also building a new flight arena here on the roof of this building to do indoor testing of flying robots, so that should be very visible from the outside, so be a very good testing area to develop those robots. The wind tunnels, actually here at the Aeronautics Department, so we have a lot of wind tunnels and water tunnels to develop those things. And we have outdoor testing, some of that in Hyde Park, so if you go to Hyde Park you see flying robots, so it might be some of ours. But we also do the testing here in the Imperial West, which is a new campus in West London, next to Long Hill. There we have a larger area for outdoor testing and development of those robots. So London is actually pretty well equipped in aerial robotics, so there are different area testing areas. We are also looking at how to establish these areas, so you all can also come and test and use our facilities to develop the robots. So something that I'm mostly also very excited about is the teaching and research labs. So I try to propose lectures and teaching labs where the students would develop those robots together along the research activities, so they would learn about UAVs and flying robots and then go out to create a lot of startups or for companies that are adapting those technologies. So it's drones for humanity, for humanitarian aid, for search and rescue, for improving our quality of life, but it's also for forests or animals or lakes, water sampling, renewable energy to maintain those facilities, water health, service and repair, and for any kind of applications where drones can benefit us all. So there are actually many of those. So Lisa, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Martin.